Everybody, welcome. This is Dr. Ed Park from Recharge Biomedical, and we're doing podcast 38 on traumatic brain injury. The impetus for this podcast was me watching SportsCenter one night and seeing football players suing in a class action suit against the NFL. And also on that very next day, patient Mary Cummings called me and said she felt she was getting some improvement in her traumatic brain injury. So like all these podcasts, these are unpaid testimonials, and they're mainly from people who are excited to share their good results. So we'll get to that at the end. There are 1.6 million cases of traumatic brain injury a year, resulting in 52,000 deaths in the United States alone, 80,000 cause permanent disability, and falls are the most common cause in people older than 65 years old, as we'll hear later from Mary's husband. You get the primary injury, of course, tears, lacerations, bleeding, and it could be penetrating or non-penetrating. But a lot of the damage is thought, which I will question the validity of, but it's thought to be from the healing, the secondary injury. In other words, the swelling, the inflammation, and the repair. Certainly, swelling can cause the brain to push on the brainstem, and that will shut you down quickly. So that's not disputable. But people have often blamed the smoke and not the fire, and I think there's a lot of goodness in the system and a lot of repair, which we'll go into. The pie chart shows mostly it's falls, motor vehicle accidents. These days, I'm told that suicide is more common in the U.S. than motor vehicle accident deaths. There's also assault, people hitting each other, and, you know, sports cause injuries too. The assessment is based on the Glasgow Coma Scale. So you get a 1 to 4 based on whether you open your eyes, whether you obey commands or can point to things, or you can even withdraw from pain. And verbal responses, whether you're alert and oriented to time and person and place, or whether you have various levels of confusion. If you're a Glasgow 15, you're fine. This triage chart kind of shows on the right. If you have severe comatose brain injury, your eyes don't open, you test to see if they respond to something like a sternal rub. You wrap your knuckles on their breastplate, and if they don't, then you got a problem. You look at your pupils, and then you just put in a breathing tube and get them to the hospital and hyperventilate them to make sure their brain swelling doesn't go up. Various degrees of lesser trauma can just go to the local emergency room if they're just a little bit confused, but anything in moderate Glasgow range, 9 to 13, should be sent to a trauma center. The chronic sequelae, or the problems from traumatic brain injury, are varied, and as you might expect in such a complicated organ as the brain, they include, especially in the immediate aftermath, seizures and headaches. Secondly, people have mood and problems with their affect, which is not just situational. It's not just because they're sad they got an accident. The regulation of their mood and their moment-to-moment feelings, called the affect, is very problematic and ends up also requiring medication, and often the medication begets more problems as well. Memory and attention problems are central. The act of being conscious and focused is apparently very difficult when you have certain sectors of your brain dysfunctioning. Long-term effects include Parkinsonism and multiple sclerosis, both of which we've done podcasts on, and which represent probably not specific diseases so much as recognizable syndromes, and also some nice anecdotal results from taking TA in those cases. If the pituitary gland, the master gland, is damaged, you get problems with hormones. Also, you can get DI or diabetes insipidus. You can't maintain your electrolyte imbalance properly. And you also can't maintain your need to urinate properly. There can be tears of the base of the skull resulting in loss of smell. It's not uncommon. And problems with vision as well as hearing. Personality can change, as well as obvious social and vocational problems. The ability to work in a steady 9-to-5 is difficult. To be able to interact with people, friends, family, partners. And then eventually, some people get into suicidal ideation and even action, as we saw with the great football hero, Junior Seau. The prognosis, we have to realize, depends on the severity. If you have a mild injury, 90% of those people will be recovered within 3 weeks. This would be like, you know, maybe butting helmets in youth football or something like that. Still very something that people are increasingly aware needs to be taken seriously. In moderate traumatic brain injury, about 2/3 of them will have some permanent deficit, which, you know, may not be obvious to a lot of people, but certainly can be elicited and subjectively reported. When there is severe traumatic brain injury, everybody has some kind of deficit. But it's important to keep in mind that, you know, there is improvement later. And even 2 years later, there is some improvement in remodeling. So it's best not to give up hope. One of the movies based on a book, I think, by Oliver Sacks was Awakening. So it's always something that warms the human heart to see that people who are shut down or locked in or dysfunctional can have quantum improvements. It really speaks to our wanting to have hope for these terrible, terrible conditions. As feelings, nothing more than feelings. And that was a song from the 70s. And what is the point of that? The point of that is that the brain is a very complicated symphony orchestra. You have different areas of specialization. Indeed, if you open a skull and walk along with an electrode, you can stimulate an area and a person will smell Play-Doh. Or, you know, if you stimulate another area, they might report seeing, you know, bright lights. So there are definite sectors which are responsible for different actions. And they communicate and they work together. So how do they do this? On the upper right, you see structures called the basal ganglia. Kind of looks like maybe a Rocky Mountain oyster there, that peach or that yellow-colored thing. These are the switching circuits in the middle of the brain. It's the relays. And then on the lower left is the limbic system. That kind of surrounds that. The limbic system is responsible for feeling. So the amygdala, see that little... it's amygdala is for almond-shaped. At the base of the system, it tells you whether you're afraid. So like the root chakra is like fear. So this is the Maslow's hierarchy. The primary concern moment to moment is fear. I mean, if you're sitting here and someone bangs on the door, forget about this webinar, you know, you're going to, the fear instinct is going to kick in. And so basically all our experience is processed by feelings. So what are feelings? I mean, feelings can be good or bad, happy or sad. But I think something that we need to acknowledge is that we are not rational creatures. The only way that we can actually experience life is through our emotions. And of course, our emotions and our consciousness can get the best of us and torture us. But without the presence of a functioning emotional system, the brain cannot work. It cannot assign value. Look at all the signal that's coming in right now. There's papers on my desk. There's an air going across my face. I can't acknowledge these things. They have to have an emotional valence. So likewise, the brain is a feeling machine. And if you've ever had something like you burned your hand on the stove when you were 5, you realize that that feeling, that fear, that experience is permanently etched in there because feelings are what generate significance, relative value. Although keep in mind, the brain works in such a way that it's constantly remodeling the past. I think a wise person said, you can't do much about the future, and that's anxiety when we try. You can't do much about the past, that's depression, but so we should live in the present. But in point of fact, the past is always being remodeled. That's the only thing we really can change. And any good historian will tell you the the facts are not the facts. We're always reconstructing them. Here's an interesting study they did on people ranging from 20 to 89 years old, and they flashed pictures of faces and houses and mishmashed nothing, and they gradually made the pictures less easy to recognize, and then they hooked them up to this thing called functional MRI. So in a functional MRI, when you flash a picture of a face, on the brain in the middle bottom there, you see that it gets hot in the temporal lobe. This is like where we recognize faces. And there's like a few things humans are really good at: language, facial recognition, and music. These are kind of uniquely human things. And they're all related because they all pertain to language and, if you will, semiotics or symbolism. If you chart how people actually, how good they are at recognizing faces, on the right you see that there's a downslope of the darker line. That's the ability to recognize faces. It goes down with age. And when they did the functional MRI, they're trying to figure out what's going on, and they saw that there was decreased functional or active brain metabolism in the areas of the brain in the temporal lobe as we got older. And that, so there was a de-differentiation. You just weren't as able to precisely identify people's faces as faces. And concomitant with that was a increased detection of houses. You could see houses well, which is interesting. So there's like a, what do they call this? There's a broadening hypothesis, meaning you're able to recognize houses more specifically, but not faces. And again, that's language. The reason I put Laughing Buddha down there is because a lot of people misunderstand what Buddhism is. Buddhism is not being stoic and sitting under a tree until you have no emotions. Well, quite the opposite. Buddhism is, I believe, experiencing life in the moment. And it's impossible, as I said in the previous slide, to experience life without emotions. So a wise, maybe even enlightened person can't live without their emotions. They still feel what? Lust, jealousy, hate. But they know to how to experience those things, process them, and watch them go by as clouds. Because if you're just enlightened without any emotions, then you're just a robot, and then you're no longer relatable as a human. So 3 years ago, there was a Nobel for the discovery of telomerase. I think 3 weeks ago, there was a Nobel Prize for the discovery, relatively recently, I think about 7 or 8 years ago, of the ability to de-differentiate cells. So there's this Japanese fellow, Yamanaka-san, and Sir John Gordon. Looks like John Hurt there a little bit, a little naughty. Anyway, they were able to take regular cells and de-differentiate them into cells that were stem-like. Why is this important? The importance of this lies in the fact that the brain doesn't heal well. You damage the brain, you got to rebuild brain, and it's not easy to do. So is that one of the ways that we can heal and trigger healing? I don't know, but let's look at what the dogma of differentiation is and then understand what these clever gentlemen did. On the upper right, they took, well, fertilized egg is a zygote, so it will differentiate to different layers, and gradually as you go down the differentiation, you gain specificity and you lose the ability to proliferate infinitely, or the telomerase activity. So what they were able to do, they took a nullipotent cell, an already grown up, totally not immortal cell, and they reprogrammed it with gene therapy to become stem-like, and they were able to produce all the downstream differentiated products. So this is very exciting because it speaks to the relatively relative ease with which we can reprogram the epigenetics of the cells and start to manipulate them and create replacement organs and true regenerative medicine. Ramon y Cajal, he's, I think, a pathologist from the early 20th century, and his dogma was what I call the red solo cup theory, which is that based on his staining of neurons, he felt that brain cells could not be regenerated, and indeed, this is the folk wisdom that we all have. probably more elevated than folk wisdom. It's the common knowledge or the group think that we would have. So just as people thought the world was flat at one point, some of the Europeans at least, so too in college when you're guzzling beer or doing crazy things, you say, oh, I'll just kill a few brain cells. And people think that you don't regrow brain cells. Well, nothing could be farther from the truth, actually. And if you ask doctors, medical doctors, board certified, I would venture to guess that 95% of them would still say humans are incapable of regenerating brain cells. So poppycock or malarkey, as Joe Biden would say. Is the world flat? I don't know. I've never been up in space, but I don't think it is. A lot of people are convinced that it's not. Here's a gentleman this week who was convinced that it's not. He flew up in a balloon. Felix is his name, and he looked out and he saw this big old blue marble, and he decided to jump out and propel himself for 4 minutes at 800 miles per hour. So this is a wonderful thing for people to do, but it definitely proves the world is not flat. What do we have on the left? It's a computer model of why the brain is also not a limited organ. It's infinite. In fact, every night when we go to sleep, we generate 10,000 brand spanking new neurons to hard code the memory. And so that's a big shift in dogma that people just don't get. You're always making new brain cells. So having said that, how come we can't bounce back real well from injury as we do with a cut on the arm? And that has to do with differentiation, scarring, things like that. This slide is called Salamander Arms or Clonal Expansion of Neural Stem Cells. What's so special about a salamander? Well, a salamander, you can cut off its arm and it'll regrow it. And it'll do it over and over again. So there are really no great, maybe one case of human regeneration, but in general, things like fingers, but certainly the complex brain, they don't regenerate well. They don't have the same plasticity or multipotency or the same kind of ability of the stem cells to act like they did when you were a fetus trying to make your first human organ. So the question is, does the brain de-differentiate or is there just neural stem cells that go everywhere and replace? When you look at the studies, it shows that what we do know is that after traumatic brain injury, these markers, surface markers, stem cell markers, do increase. So whatever the method, whether it's de-differentiation or just a lot of stem cell recruitment, it appears that there's just a lot more stem cells trying to fix the situation. And the brain does regenerate. Neurogenesis, which is the ability to create these 10,000 new brain cells, happens in three main areas. The subgranular zone, in the dentate gyrus, the subventricular zone, and also in a third area, which now eludes me. The point is, when you injure a brain, there is regeneration, and these neural stem cells do migrate like little amoebas all over the place and do attempt to regenerate nerves. So, you know, you would think the old dogma is if you cut a nerve, there's nothing going to reconnect that, so you're done. Well, apparently there are sort of tracks or trade routes or paths, and these cells can make some kind of attempt to reconnect. But, of course, you know, you sever a spinal cord, it's pretty unlikely that that will reconnect. So it's all about the limited capacity to regenerate and the existing damage there. Microglia were thought to be bad. These are like the kind of like the T cells of the brain. The brain is a privileged space. It's kind of separated by the blood-brain barrier from the rest of the body so that every little thing doesn't cause us to have meningitis and die. So very tight junctions in the blood system. Everything going in and out of the brain is tightly regulated. So T cells become these things called microglia, and they do the same things. They recognize hosts and antigens. They chew up stuff. They clear up stuff. It used to be thought they were bad, but in fact, they're just doing their work like Oompa Loompas. So what is the reparative capacity of the brain? Here's an article looking at telomerase activity, and it says that these white blood cells in the brain, the microglia, do show increased telomerase activity. And so they are the primary cells involved with clearing the debris, causing and clearing the inflammation, trying to pave or repave brain cells after injury. As I've been taking this for 5 years and prescribing it for four, I've come to realize that what we're really doing is empowering sleep, and sleep is the master repair mechanism. This is the time when your body certainly repairs, and there's a great webinar on sleep and circadian rhythms, which if that interests you, you can look at. But let's look at sleep cycles on the left. In a healthy child, you get 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe 5 cycles, 8 hours of sleep, 7.5, each one being roughly 1.5 hours. The first 2 cycles physical, the latter ones more time in what we call REM sleep, or it's actually not a deep sleep. It's a very shallow sleep where your eyes are moving and there's consciousness. As we get older, in the old elderly people, there's so many frequent awakenings. You stay very shallow. You don't get to the deep, deep stage 4 delta sleep where your body's paralyzed and your brain waves are slow. So sleep is disturbed both by a failure in the circadian pineal gland regulation, but also because you got a lot more to worry about. You got grandkids and reverse mortgages and what have you. But I think this picture of Salvador Dali really sums it up, and this is called the persistence of memory in the top right. It's these soft watches and these crawling ants and this sort of like, so you got this thing that happens to you in the day, and then somehow that has to be made into meaning. So when you go to sleep at night, this is a defragmenting picture, like that's what the drive on your computer, the hard drive looks like. It's actually a disk. So you got these centers that are free, that are green, and then fragmented, like red. So the bottom right shows what the brain is doing when you're sleeping. It's fragmenting, defragmenting, moving around. So again, you're reassigning significance to all your thoughts and memories and actions and other people around you. That's the purpose of sleep. Without sleep, without defragmenting, you become unhealthy and the bad consciousness reigns, and then your body can't even heal because you're not going deep into sleep. It's a high cortisol state. It's a high stress state. It's a very low consciousness, very cold and fearful vibration, which accelerates our aging. Okay. A little change here on the clinical management of traumatic brain injury. Standard therapy is, which, you know, when you're a med student or a resident, they teach you, it's just folk wisdom. You don't question the wise professor when he says, hook him up and give him a mannitol, which is like an osmotic diuretic. It decreases the volume and helps you pee. Barbiturates, which are a brain sedative, and steroids to reduce inflammation. But when you look at this, the things that we thought were much better than nothing, the question arises, are they truly better than nothing? Now, I know the people that were involved a little bit. I interviewed for a job once with Dave Grimes, who's one of the head priests of the evidence-based medicine movement. And so what this was about, maybe almost 20 years ago, they said, hey, doctors aren't witch doctors. We should look at the available literature, weigh it in terms of whether it's A study, a B, an A would be a randomized controlled double-blind trial versus like D or E, stuff that's just case reports like what we're doing. And so there's became this love affair with people using this questionable methodology of combining disparate studies into one uber meta study. And so the methodology is extremely suspect, but basically, when you look at all these traditional therapies for brain trauma, none of them really pass muster. So, which is not to say that I necessarily believe in evidence-based medicine either as a religion. So, you know, I used to deliver babies, and you can tell me evidence-based medicine till the cows come home, but I definitely have seen enough fetal heart tracings to know what's good, what's bad, and that there is some value there. But you have to be careful with your love affair of evidence. Two podcasts ago, we talked about aging and AIDS, and one thing I dug up in the literature was that when you look at people with Alzheimer's, you have aging of their white blood cells versus controls. So the question arises, these senescent CD28 negative, which are burnt out T cells, they are increased. Now, is that confounding or is that causation? What is confounding and causation? Well, upper right will show, let's say you have you know, a common cause, okay? Like riding a treadmill. So riding a treadmill will, you know, cause you to lose weight and feel be healthier. Riding a treadmill might also cause you to wear Lycra shorts. So the question is the Lycra shorts causing the weight loss and the good shape? No, but they're associated. So we have to always be careful in saying these just so stories. Well, you did this, and that includes TA. You did this, you got better, so it's the TA. That's confounding. Now, certainly if exposure is riding the bike, then yeah, maybe that does cause the good outcome. But we can even dissect further down. What is it about riding the bike? And for that, you should watch the exercise podcast. But it could be the telomerase activation is not confounding variable, but the causal variable. So why do we say that? When the cells, the T cells, get shortened and damaged and non-functional, they can't get to the brain and become these healthy microglial cells. So that may be contributing to the inefficient clearance of damaged cells in the brain, and also causing this increased pro-inflammatory markers, which are common in all the bad diseases of atherosclerosis and inflammation and everything. So be careful. It might, in this case, the failing of the immune system might be causing aging in all its organs, especially in the brain, and especially relevant to our talk of traumatic brain injury, in that you have to have a healthy T system to repair and restore. Now, when you look at the brain cells in an older person, as they did on this left study, they found that as you got older in Alzheimer's, that it was a 1 in 10,000 chance that the blood cells were not related to shorter, or telomere shortening was associated with Alzheimer's. In the buccal cells, which is your skin cheek cells and inside mucus cells, there's a 1 in 100 chance that they weren't related. So bottom line, shortening telomeres associated with Alzheimer's. But look at the actual autopsied cells of the hippocampus. The hippocampus is that limbic system master organ generating the emotions and the feelings and coding the memory. There's greater telomere length as you get older. Well, that wasn't expected. Why is that? It's because in the brain and in the testicles, these are such important organs for different reasons, that there is overkill, for want of a better term. Your telomerase activity is so high that you actually accumulate excess telomere length. And so that could also be attributed to the system being slightly damaged and trying to repair. Telomerase activity could be upregulated. So let's look at this histogram on the bottom left. When you look at the white blood cells and the buccal cells, these are the p-values showing that the absolute telomere length was definitely shorter in people with Alzheimer's versus non. On the right histogram, when you see the telomere length in the controls, it was longer. So, unexpected result. Look at the study. This is not the first study showing that older men have impart a longer telomere length to their children. Now, it's thought that a lot of the epigenetic reprogramming is carried with the egg, not the sperm, but old dudes love to hear that their kids are going to be superhuman, living longer. But this, in fact, is somewhat of a true artifact. So, again, why is that? Well, we need our brains to think, even though the brain wasn't designed to live past 30, 40 years. And we need our testicles to impart our genes and our descendants. So there has to be excellent error correction and immortal stem cell viability through telomerase. On the upper right is Soledad, very nice lady, 113 years old. And if you go and talk to her, she sings and she jokes, which is great. She makes jokes. She's got great emotional life. And so she's intact. She probably has superhuman telomerase activity. So why do we bring this up? Again, you would assume, and again, the adage is don't assume anything, you make an ass out of you and me. So you would assume that older people have shorter telomeres in their brain. Well, you would be wrong. Their telomeres are longer. And you would assume as you get older, they have more cancer. Again, totally wrong. They have less cancer. So what does that indicate? It could be, again, a common cause, telomerase activity being high, leading to lower rates of cancer, leading to lower rates of Alzheimer's. Okay, why Jack LaLanne? Here, Jack LaLanne was the healthiest dude in the world. He could have lived 200 years if not for the fact that he had run out of his immune system. So the immune system is important. And check out podcast 36 to understand why AIDS is really just a form of aging. And aging is a form of lowercase AIDS or an acquired immune deficiency. Jesus said... He told the parable, and parables operate on different levels, but he said that there was a sower, a guy who was planting seeds who went out, and when it came to pass, as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and the birds of the air came and devoured it up. Some fell on stony ground where it had not much earth, and others fell on good ground and did yield fruit that sprang up and increased and brought forth 30, 60, 100 fold. And he said to them, he that has ears to hear, let him hear. What is the point of this parable? The point is, you can have functioning neural stem cells going all around, but if the matrix, if the soil is not good, is a result of traumatic brain injury, or let's say a myocardial infarction, or liver cirrhosis, these little stem cells, these seeds, are not able to do their thing within the matrix. They're not able to... get the right differentiation signals from the local milieu, and they're not able to create tracks and connections along existing pathways. And so a lot of what happens with aging might be damage not to the cells and the genes, but actually to the matrix in which they live. And I think nothing could be more relevant for this theory than brain damage, seeing as it is a closed, limited, and highly formalized space. So this may be part of the problem with brain injury. Well, let's see at the bottom here. Here's the glial scar, GS, versus the FS, the fiber scar, and one is the mirror image of the other. So this reflects brain injury. The glia, which are mainly astrocytes, they come in and they try and clear the damaged cells, and this inflammation causes like a scar, like a keloid scar. So the glial cells form their own little patch, and then they create fiber, collagen, and that is damaged ground. That's not going to be amenable to reconnecting nerves and planting healthy seeds. So here on the upper left, we see activated astrocytes. These are these nerve cells, and in there are microglia, or the immune cells, and oligodendrocytes are laying down the insulation for the axons. Here's this big old cyst, like an abscess. This is the problem. They're trying to heal whatever's going on, whether it be infection or inflammation. And so they create a physical obstacle to good neurogenesis. It's also represented in the upper right, same thing. You've got these neurons trying to create their little roots and cross a scar tissue valley. It's not going to happen. So this is a big problem, which if we could clear out with precision the fibers and de-differentiate or introduce healthy neural stem cells, you'd get more brain regeneration. This came across from my good friend Dwight. He always sends me cutting-edge science. So on the upper left, maybe a month or two ago, some Spanish scientists developed an intelligent device that lays down the future. And this is what I always tell my patients about aging. Just stay healthy now, and then by 20 years, they'll have ways to cell by cell destroy the damaged cells and replace them, again, with the reprogramming that the Japanese Nobel winner and the other knight created. They'll be able to custom order your own perfect copies of cells and regenerate your liver or your cornea for you. But in the meantime, the problem is these bad cells that are there and they can't be killed. Well, these guys came up with a device that are nanoparticles that go in and they find cells that are aged. They show markers of aging and maybe they'll release a little poison. So this would be cellular-based magic bullet therapy. It's still in the future, but then the reason I said I was 4 for 4 is because I wrote this comic book, graphic novel, about 5 years ago, and I predicted Nobel Prize for telomerase activation, which happened, pet cloning, people cloning their pets, which happened, adult entertainment through virtual reality, which obviously everyone saw coming. And then fourthly, nanosites. This gentleman is the villain of my story. This doctor wants to, he's dying of cancer, and he wants to download his consciousness into his son's body. And what they're doing in the meantime is keeping him alive with nanosites, which were this theoretical little robots that go around and kill cancer cells. If you want to download my comic book, it's, I think, 99 cents on the iTunes store. It's called Maximum Lifespan, and there's a whole bunch of other predictions in there, and it's kind of a fun story about a kid that gets his body hijacked by his dad. All right, enough of that. So let's go to the actual fun stuff, which is Mary C. And Mary Cummings, who called me up this week or the last and said, hey, I think I'm getting better. So I'm always a bit skeptical, but I present the data, and she, it's a very subjective experience, but let's see what she has to say about what happened to her.
I skied into a tree, probably at something like 40 or 50 miles an hour. I'm an expert skier. It was Christmas Day. I was having a great time. I don't remember a thing. The next thing I remember is I woke up 3 weeks later on life support. So I had, from my eye sockets down, all my bones in my face were shattered, including my jaw was broken. Well, so I noticed the biggest problem I have is my memory. My memory has been one of my biggest issues because I don't have good short-term memory now. And so I have to constantly do things to put a reminder to even remind myself. It's silly, but I won't look at my calendar because I won't know that I'm forgetting something.
Oh, wow, okay.
It's like severe ADD, too. It's like I get distracted easily, so I'll be in the middle of a project, walk out of the room, get distracted by something else.
So your focus is difficult.
Difficult. This is the interesting thing. So I started a month ago your product, and I went, I feel like my brain, the product is helping my brain be more like it used to be.
More plastic, more malleable.
Well, like I was remembering things in a different way, like I was more like my old self once I got onto it. That's what made me think it's helping heal the brain injury.
So just that's a little more flexibility in your memory, more associations being formed, things like that?
Possibly that, and maybe it was like I suddenly felt I understood things better. I didn't feel as much as if I was in, I feel sometimes like I'm in a fog.
Right.
Okay, so thanks, Mary, for introducing us to this idea. The main case we want to present is one that came up last year. It's a guy named Tony Schoneval from Australia, and he's a real pioneer of trying to heal himself. And so he found out about us through Life Extension Foundation. His story is that he worked in Vietnam as a soldier and had some post-traumatic stress over what went on there, and was depressed, and in the aftermath, he got in a horrible motor vehicle accident in 1979 and spent a full 3 months in a coma. And, you know, in the first year of rehab, he basically, people were saying, oh, you're lucky to be alive, but he didn't really feel lucky to be alive. He felt like he was totally non-functional as a person. And so he struggled with that on and off. He had two more other brain injuries, but the first one was the doozy. And so left him really depressed and with a lot of post-traumatic stress and bad back and shoulder and et cetera. So he tried, he kind of went on to 4 pills a night a year ago, August, for 6 months. Just want to point out our email correspondence because I think it shows how his language improved even over the course of like four days. Initial correspondence here from Tony. There's grammatical problems, and I'll leave it for you to read this later if you like, but there's a lot of run-on sentences. I'm not an English teacher, but I can tell there's run-on sentences. Punctuation is all question marks, no commas. And the spelling errors, there's syntax and word diction errors. But, you know, like, for example, he says, I have made an appointment with a local cancel specialist to run tests, etc., to make sure that I am such a condition, is not dormant, etc., as I understand that cancer is still a concern referring to TA65 therapy. So, I mean, that's a run-on sentence. And it's just unclear what he's asking. I mean, obviously, we can make it out because we have hopefully functioning brains, but there's typos, there's lack of appropriate punctuation and run-on and et cetera. The next one comes, he's still not taking TA. And again, what we see here from the email is there's no punctuation, it's run-on. Let's see. So he says, thank you, one word, for your reply. Yes, I will try again 8 a.m. Tuesday. Again, there's no commas, there's nothing here. My number is blah, blah, blah. I admit that I get a little confused with overseas numbers simply because the item and dialing is misspelled. And anyway, it's a bit like hard to understand. Here we go. Still not taking it, but he is writing here. And it's better. He's at least using paragraphs now. There's still typos. There's lose of vision and telomeres, apostrophe S. Again, these last three lines end with no punctuation. You know, it's not horrible. What's interesting is after he starts taking, this is the 15th. He takes it on the day of the 15th and the 16th. This is his email to me. And what you notice is it's terse. To the point, the exclamation mark makes its appearance, which is the appearance of emotion. And so, again, much more intelligible email correspondence. He says, hi, Ed. I mean, before he struggled with the salutation, it was no salutation. Hi, Ed Park, MD. Then, dear Dr. Ed Park. And then, hi, Ed. So I'm more at ease. He says, things are not going well on two fronts. Period. So he introduces the topic well. I mean, it's a well-composed letter. Firstly, I went and saw a cancer specialist that was impressed, but he then said he can only recommend that I stop taking TA65. I mean, look at how wonderful the flow of the language is there. Reason simply, there are no recognized reports that he is aware of supporting the use of it for any reason, exclamation mark. Recognized is not a misprint. It's a Commonwealth spelling of that. And it's conversational, certainly, but it's cogent and terse. Have you tried to contact the media referring to my use of TA65? Oh, have tried. No feedback at all, question mark. Hope it works. Would be nice to show it's not a waste of my... Pardon me. So let's listen to Tony after 5 weeks last year on TA65. And he seems to be having a nice time of it. Didn't think he would be that clear speaking based on the correspondence that I had received from him. But again, a gentleman who suffered multiple traumatic brain injuries. So let's listen to what he sounded like. This will be a couple of minutes, 5 weeks into TA65. And I think you, in all fairness, you know, it might not be all brain. You can hear that he's happy. He's got a elation in his mood. But I think you will see that his use of language, of irony, word choice, his understanding of himself in his context of healing is all very sophisticated.
So you have depression and post-traumatic stress disorder?
Oh, yeah. What suicidal was... depression fits and all that sort of junk, yeah.
Where were you in the service?
In Nam.
Vietnam?
Yeah.
That was a tough one.
Yeah, it wasn't the best show out.
No.
But I'm getting to deal with it much better now.
Yeah. Tell me... the motor vehicle accident that you had, what year was that?
The first one was back in 79, December.
Which is the one that caused the brain damage?
That one.
79?
So the other one.
Okay.
Yeah, that one caused the serious damage. That's the one I spent months in coma and stuff.
Oh my God. So, you lost the ability to remember short term?
Well, when I woke up, I had over a year with total memory loss, much longer than that. And then when I finally got memory back and I managed to get things going again, it was short-term memory became a real baffle at times. You didn't know where you were and that sort of thing.
And then the aftermath of your rest of your adult life, you've had kind of trouble with memory and organizing thoughts and function and that kind of thing?
Oh, yes. Okay. Yes, and expressing myself and dealing with feelings and what memory was all about, and to do simple things which I normally used to be able to do, and I couldn't work anything out on how to do it now.
Yeah. And how's your social integration at this point, Tony? Virtual none.
The total fear of people and expressing and being able to talk to other people about things, about how I feel or express anything.
You seem very reasonable to me, very intact.
Yeah, I know, it's fabulous, isn't it? Worry, because as soon as I think positively, that's all taking place, bang, something happens. It's not.
We'll just stay off the motorcycles, yeah?
Oh, definitely, yes.
Okay, so...
I'd love to have a Harley, though.
Well, my friend, so let me ask you, so how long have you been on it? Like 2 weeks now, right? At least 3 weeks?
Oh, it must be 3 or 4 weeks.
Good.
I've done one complete bottle.
Nice.
I started on my second bottle-y thing. Yes.
And how is the sleep quality? Is it restful for you?
Oh, yes, yes.
Yeah. And your mood? How is your mood? I mean, you dream a lot, right? Do you dream more? Or
yes, I started dreaming more. No, first few nights I woke up with absolute memory for a short time on dreaming because it was so real. Now I get some idea, but I definitely do dream. Before, since the accidents, I've had very little in dream.
Mm. So you feel?
So it's
It's a change since taking the TA.
Yes,
way. Is it content, or is it the ability to memorize it, or to remember it, or is it the excitement, or the topics that it draws from? What is different exactly?
Well, it's the topics in which it draws on how I deal with the situation, as if it's pointing things out. It's very exciting that I have them, and I wake up very, almost tired in a way, but very refreshed as well. Like this morning, okay, I know I've been in dream last night, but I gave no thing to remember. I didn't even try to remember. But you feel much better after them.
Hmm. How's your mood?
Yes.
How's your mood and thought process? Is it better during the day?
Much better.
Good.
Much better. Yeah.
In what way?
I'm becoming more fluent and flowing and clearer in what I'm thinking, and to a degree, even at this moment. I didn't realize I stuttered. That's only just started.
No. It's not really a full-blown. It's just that the words come out appropriately. It's just a minor thing. I've never spoken to you before. Right.
So no.
I wouldn't even call it stuttering. It's not Frank stuttering, to be honest with you. It's just a hesitation.
I feel a bit of repetitive, but like I'm on the hesitance of saying something.
Hesitant, but the word choice is appropriate. I mean, you get the appropriate word, so you just... What's happening, I think, is you're getting used to the thoughts coming in at a faster bandwidth. That's all. Yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty close to explaining what it is. There's a hold-up, so to speak. So I get a bit of a... Yes.
Good. Well, that's lovely. I haven't spoken to you before, but you certainly sound very good to me. So if I had talked to you a month ago, it wouldn't have been the same deal?
No.
A little harder to keep up a conversation and avoid maybe awkward things?
Yes, it would have been. You'd have to lead the whole way because there'd be a lot of anxiety about it. And I just wouldn't be... Yeah, it would have been far more difficult.
Well, you sound brilliant to me, my friend. Perfectly clear.
Okay, so that's Tony, 5 weeks on TA-65. And then this is last week I caught up with him. He'd been off the TA for 8 months. I mean, it's obviously not easy to afford. And I think that what he referenced at the end of that call, you can detect here, a little hesitancy, inability to initiate and continue the conversation, terse one-word answers, and obviously anxiety about the success of the conversation. Let's listen to what he sounded like a week ago.
we talked last year when you first started the TA, and I remember a letter you wrote me was very confusing, but then it seemed like you came out of a cloud a bit there.
Yeah, probably.
You weren't as scared to talk to people, in other words.
It's possible. I don't have much memory.
So you're kind of going backwards a little bit in terms of your memory?
Yeah.
Oh, that's too bad.
We're going through a memory improvement with many things now, and I'm hoping to overcome that shortly.
So, you know, obviously he's not as excited about things, and his mood is not as good, and a little bit monosyllabic and flat. Again, the failure of the emotional circuitry to function, as well as the whole meta-understanding of the conversation and where it was going. The final case is just more of a little, just a little grace note almost, but I was talking to Dr. Ruth Hauk in Texas, and her husband is a World War II veteran, really bad health. He's probably 88 years old, really bad back. He uses a walker. But he fell from a ladder and got a subdural hematoma and a Broca's aphasia. So he has really a problem with speaking. He cannot speak. He can't find words. Interestingly, his other side, the Wernicke's area on the left, this is the left side of the brain, the language side, the Wernicke's area is intact, so he can listen to books on tape about mining and about the Civil War. He's a buff on both those subjects. He really likes to listen to that before he goes to sleep. And he can understand everything his wife, Ruth, is saying. But he's unable to form language because there was damage to the Broca's area. And Broca's area is the one that chooses the words. So he couldn't, you know, if he had words on a refrigerator magnet, he couldn't do that either. He's just unable to create symbolic language. So he started about 4 months, 5 months ago, and he's 88 years old. He doesn't have a lot of function left other than the ability to understand all these things. And he started to smile a lot and sleep a ton more. And, of course, the leitmotif here is that sleeping is reparative. So all of a sudden he's sleeping 12 hours a night, 10 hours a night. Something's going on upstairs. So she recalls something last week that was unusual, that had never occurred and certainly hadn't occurred in years because of his visual impairment. Also, we did a podcast on macular degeneration if you want to look that up. But let's listen to what she has to say.
He said something today that surprised me. He was looking out the window. He looks out the window a lot more. He just goes over and looks. Of course, I've got a beautiful water garden in the backyard, and he goes over there and he looks at it. But what he called my attention to was a bird that was flying across the backyard that he saw. That is new.
What do you mean?
He really can't see something that far away. And he saw the bird flying across the backyard, and he called it to my attention, which he has never done before. So that was brand new.
Well, that's kind of neat. Don't you think?
Oh, that he could see the bird flying across the backyard? Absolutely.
And, yeah, and that he wanted to share it with you, too.
Yes. Yeah.
Did he seem happy or just kind of surprised?
Oh, yeah. He was smiling about it. And when he was looking out the back door tonight at supper time, he was looking out across the backyard where I have my water garden, and I went up and put my arm around him and said, "Oh, do you like that?" And he said, "Oh, yeah." Well, he didn't say the words, but it was the body reaction that was, yeah, he really liked it.
Oh.
Which means he can see it a little better, because before that, he would never go to the door to look out.
That was a really nice story that Ruth shared with us. You know, of course, that age and that damage level, we don't expect an awakening or a miracle, but I would argue that is kind of a miracle, ability to see, share, and enjoy is all that all of us are just asking for, you know, wherever our consciousness is. So that's really the talk today. We'll do questions. The girls have been doing the raffle. Oh, there's Ruth. Dawn, a complete sentence to answer my question last Friday and is ready to do some speech therapy. Wow, that was unexpected. Hi, Ruth, can we hear you? Can you hear Ruth?
Can you hear me now?
Oh, yeah, hi. How are you, Doc?
Well, it was really interesting. We were looking out the window again, and I'd asked him a question about what he thought about the water garden. And I have to tell you, I didn't remember exactly what he said, but it was a complete sentence, and I understood every word.
Wow. How long has that been since he's used a complete sentence?
Well, probably since his brain injury 25 years ago.
That must have been alarming or strange.
That's why I don't. Well, that's why I don't remember what he said. I was so stunned that it's the first time he's done that.
Wow!
But we did make a good time. We did make a good time out of it. We, you know, carried on a little conversation, very short. Sometimes most of his words are yes or no, but then he'll say, coffee, we're working on him telling me what he wants for breakfast now. So we're working on some more sentences.
Wow. So really, I mean, up until just this week, he has been unable to form words. Is that true?
Complete sentences. He can use single words.
Oh, okay. He has words. Okay.
Yeah.
But I misunderstood. He can do like monosyllabic commands and things like that?
He can answer yes, no, but if he wants something and he can't come up with the word, our reply is, can you show me? And then he'll take me and show me or draw pictures.
Hmm. Interesting.
The verbal language is very limited.
So really, you have like a 2-year-old now. You're just going to relearn language.
Yes, and besides, he had his 91st birthday last Tuesday.
Oh, sorry. I gypped him out of a few years there. So he's making some kind of change or U-turn, whatever. Have you changed anything else in his regimen other than the TA? Has anything else changed?
No, no. I never argue with him, of course, but I cajole him.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, that's pretty exciting. So he's been on it for 6 months at 3 a night. Is that correct?
Probably not 6 months. Maybe I think we started probably in May. I think we started. So, but yes, he's been on 3 a night for probably 4 of those 5 months.
And even initially, was something you noticed was he sleeping more and smiling, right? Was there anything else that you noticed?
Well, when we first started, he really wasn't very cooperative. He would just kind of do what he wanted to do, and no matter whether I cajoled him or not. But this recently, he has become very cooperative, and he always comes out of the table, smiles now, and is willing to work on forming language, forming words. Part of the damage has been he cannot control some of the mouth positions to make the sounds correctly, such as the voiced and unvoiced sounds like the P and the B. He has trouble with that explosive part of the language.
Yep. Interesting. Wow. Well, I'm really glad you tuned in. I didn't realize you were going to be listening. That's great. How are you feeling? Do you feel okay taking it? You take 3 a night as well, or?
I do that, and sometimes I sleep well, and sometimes I don't. So, and I don't dream either. I don't think he dreams, but I don't dream either. But I'm sleeping a little better than what I did, and I'll probably have to make some changes so that I get off of the computer before I go to bed.
Yeah, you got to be careful what you do before sleep, because it can really mess you up. Now, how's your hair and nails, your skin?
Actually, I see them improving because I'm 86, but my wrinkles around my cheeks, they are disappearing, and all of my aging spots are gone.
Hmm. Interesting. Well, good. That sounds great. Anything else you want to share with people? Say they have a loved one with traumatic brain injury, I mean, it took a while, a lot of patience and faith to see this sentence come out, what, like 4 or 5 months. So, I mean, would you think that it's something that people should try or?
Trying certainly won't hurt, but it is expensive.
Yeah. Well, that's great. I'm glad to hear that he's making a path towards, you know, useful speech therapy. That's exciting. Okay, Ruth. Thanks for calling in. We'll leave you on.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Traumatic brain injury. Really bad. But, you know, I don't know that the TA was the factor here, but whatever it was, even if it's just my amazing powers of placebo persuasion, I think the line that says it all is that she couldn't remember what he said because she was so shocked that he had actually formed a sentence. I think that is just amazing. And, you know, that's what we're all looking to do. Understand a little more and share it. And at 91, to make that kind of U-turn just really makes me happy, and I think should make everyone happy. So again, traumatic brain injury, just to sum up, is not a permanent thing. It's just really hard to fix, whether it be through dedifferentiation or neural stem cell proliferation, telomerase activation, nanocytes. It's not here, but it's coming soon. So definitely never give up hope on that. And I think you could definitely hear in Tony's voice, and he's decided since our call recently to go back on. So, you know, where there's life, there's hope. And I think that if you know somebody who's battling depression or hopelessness, whether it be from TBI or any other thing, be a friend, get engaged. People that knew Junior Seau said he was like multiple or two different people, and they didn't see it coming necessarily. So a lot of that could be the medication you're on. A lot of it could be brain damage. But if you have a sense that somebody's spiraling or losing control of the reins or becoming hopeless, worst of all, do something. Because, again, the effect of hopelessness is self-annihilation in some form, and that's terrible. Because when we lose somebody, it's like burning down a whole library. So let's try and maintain connectedness. Anyway, Dr. Ed Park from Recharge Biomedical, ending podcast 38 on traumatic brain injury. Everybody, thanks a lot for attending, and we'll see you next time. Take care. Bye.
We're not gonna take it. Never did and never will. We're not gonna take it. Gonna break it. Gonna shake it. Let's forget it. Better still. Now you can hear me. Your ears are truly sealed. Speak either. Your mouth is filled. You can't see nothing. And pinball completes the scene. Here comes Uncle Ernie to guide you to your very own machine. You don't seem to see me, but I think you can see yourself.
You seem very reasonable to me, very intact.
Yeah, I know, it's fabulous, isn't it?
I'm free. I'm free. And I'm waiting for you to follow me. What it takes to reach the highest high. You'd laugh and say nothing's that simple. But you've been told many times before. Messiah's pointed to the door. No one had the guts to leave the temple. I'm free.